Hello, welcome to yet another video on SRID Cloud. And in this video, we want to talk about a typical data center networking. So let's get started. So this topology shows three routers and a switch and a bunch of computers connected to the switch. Most importantly, the computers are divided. The VLAN 100 in green, they are divided from the VLAN 1000 computers. So these two computers in the VLAN 1000 can talk to each other, and these two computers in VLAN 100 can talk to each other, but they cannot talk across. That is the intention behind this topology. So how do we accomplish that? Using this switch configuration and also this router configuration. And another requirement for this topology is to maintain this R1 as a core router that routes between the internal blue and green network and to R2, which is the edge router. Think of R1 and R2 and the switch and all these computers are inside a data center. And R2 provides the edge services. So anybody who wants to communicate to this data center will come to R2. And just to simulate an external network, I created R3, the third router. And I'm going to explain the concepts like VLANs, the port channels and channel groups and VRFs and BGPs and so on to implement this particular topology. So let's start with VLANs. These four computers are connected, cabled to this particular switch. And let us look at the switch configuration. The fast Ethernet 00 and 01 are connected to these two PCs in 192.168.1.0 network in VLAN 1000. And fast Ethernet 03 and 04 are connected to the PCs 3 and 4 in 192.168.2.0 network. And the router R1 is connected to fast Ethernet 02. And as I was saying earlier, these two cables from PC 3 and 4 will allow or should allow the traffic between them. And these two cables between these two computers in the VLAN 1000 should allow communication between them. But all four of them should go through this cable on fast Ethernet 02 all the way to the router 1. And from there, the traffic should flow to R2. And from R2, it can flow to R3 if desired. So the network traffic is required to be separated all the way to R2. So how do we accomplish that is what we are going to see next. So now let's look into this switch, first of all. On this switch, I have configured all five ports. So let's look at the running configuration. Let's skip all these things for now. So here is fast Ethernet 00. In this diagram, the fast Ethernet 00 is connected to VLAN 1000 and to the PC 1. And it is isolated from the green network with the VLAN 1000. And the VLAN 1000 is tagged into this interface or a port, I should say, with this command, switch port access VLAN 1000. So this will put this port, fast Ethernet 00, under VLAN 1000. Similarly, the VLAN 1000 is also on the fast Ethernet 01, which is the section right next to it. So now the these two, the green, that's about blue network. The green network, similar things are configured. So fast Ethernet 03 and 04 are on VLAN 100. So if you noticed, all four of them carry the same statement, switch port, access VLAN, and then the VLAN number. Now how about this Fast Ethernet 02, which is connected to the router? So that should carry both VLANs. So how do we do that? And that is done with the help of trunk mode. So Fast Ethernet 02 is configured as a trunk port. So that is about VLANs. So if PC3 wants to talk to PC4, the traffic will flow from PC3 all the way to the switch on Fast Ethernet 04, and it will go out on Fast Ethernet 03 successfully back to PC4 because both 03 and 04 are on the same VLAN. Similarly, Fast Ethernet 00 and 01. If this PC2 for some reason wants to talk to PC4, that is not allowed. So the traffic will flow from PC2 all the way to the switch. And since it is on an entirely different, the PC4 is connected on an entirely different VLAN, the switch will not forward that packet. Okay, so far so good. Now, as I said earlier, this interface between the switch and R1, the router 1, is common for both VLANs. So how do we separate the traffic between these two VLANs at the router level? If I don't do anything, then the traffic will flow from PC4, say for example, all the way to the switch to the router, and then back to switch, and then back to PC2. So PC4 will be able to talk to PC2 if I don't do anything at this router level. But that is not what we want. So to accomplish this traffic separation between the networks at the router level, a couple of things are done. First of all, VRFs, the virtual routing and forwarding, is configured on this router 1. I'll show you how that is done. We're going to create a VRF A and VRF B, one for each of these VLANs. But this connectivity between the switch and the router is only one. So how do we put both networks on this one cable? To accomplish that, we will create port channels. So let's see how that is done. Let's close this one for now and go to this router 1. So on this router 1, I'm going to show you the running configuration and then explain how that is done. So now, first of all, a couple of VRFs are created on this router, VRF A and VRF B. And a route descriptor is also created for them, 1:1 and 2:2. You can put whatever you want, but just to distinguish between these two, they have to be unique. And the address family is set to IPv4. It is not IPv6, it's only IPv4. And then, let's skip all these things for now. A port channel is created. This is how you create a port channel and call it as port channel number 1. And create a couple of sub-interfaces on the port channel. One for each VLAN, like port channel 1.100 and port channel 1.1000. And also add the encapsulation.1Q100 statement here and then encapsulation.1Q1000 statement here to put these two port channel sub-interfaces on the respective VLANs. And also mark the VRFs, VRF forwarding B and VRF forwarding A on the respective port channels. And finally, the IP address, the gateway IP address for these two networks, 192.168.1.0, its gateway IP is 192.168.1.1, and that is on the port channel 1.1000. And similarly, 192.168.2.1 is the gateway for the green network, and it is on the port channel 1.100. So with this setup, the traffic is isolated at the router level also. So So let's see what we can do to prove that. So I am at the router now, and if I try to ping any one of those four PCs, like 192.168.1.2, for example, it will not go through. This is somewhat strange, isn't it? Like the router is connected to the switch, and switch is connected to the PC, or other way around, the PC is connected to the switch is connected to the router. Why can't I ping it? It is not working because we implemented VRFs on the router. So what we need to do is, when we ping, we need to specify the VRF, and then 192.168.1.2. This will go through. So you have to specify on which VRF you are trying to ping an intended destination. So we can try the other one as well, 1.3. So these are the two PCs on the blue network, and obviously if you want to ping the green network computer, you need to specify the corresponding VRF, and similarly 2.3. So this is how the VRFs are used to isolate the traffic in the router. So finally, I want to show you something. Show IP route on this router. It does not show anything at all. So this is called the global address table on this router, which is empty, because all the routing are in the corresponding VRFs. So show IP route VRF A shows the 192.168.1 network. So forget about these entries. We'll talk about them later. So these three entries is how the traffic flows from the router to the endpoint, and then back and forth. And similarly, if I do the other VRF, it contains the route for the 2.0 network, 192.168.2.0 network, through the port channel 1.100. So this is how the traffic is divided. The VLANs are used on the switch, and VRFs are used along with the port channels in the router. If there is no VRFs, and if there is no VRF, then there's no need for the port channels, then the traffic will flow from the green network to the blue network and back and forth, because by default the router will route between VLAN 100 network and VLAN 1000 network. So in order to prevent it, we implemented VRFs and port channels. There's one more piece of information I forgot to mention, that when you create the port channel, it has to be associated with the physical interface as well. So this is the E0 interface on this router that is connected to the switch. That's a gigabit Ethernet 1 interface. There's something needs to be done on that. Let me do the show run again. And if you noticed, we already talked about the port channel 1 and the its sub interfaces, and it has to be attached to the physical interface, the Gigabit Ethernet 1, with the help of channel group keyword. So by doing this, the port channel sub interfaces and the port channel itself is connected to the physical port, the Gigabit Ethernet 1. And similarly, on the other side of the router, the R1 to R2, I did something exactly the same thing. So what I did was, on the same R1, I created another port channel called port channel 2, and two additional sub interfaces on it, similar to what we did for the southern direction. So this is for the northern direction of the router R1 towards R2. And then I attached the channel group 2, the port channel 2 actually, with the help of channel group 2, in the physical interface between the R1 and R2 on the R1 side. So just to summarize, on R1, two port channels were created, and one is for the VRFA and one for VRFB. And on the northern direction also, I created two different port channels and placed them in the corresponding VRFs. And now let's look at the R2. So there has to be something similar here as well. Let's see. So make it as big as possible. Now let's look at the configuration. So on this also, I created a VRFA and VRFB. So don't worry about rest of the stuff here for now. The VRF definitions are very similar to what we did in the other router, the R1 router. Okay. And I ended up creating another VRF called Internet, which we will talk about in a moment. But these two VRFs, VRF A and B, are also attached to something similar. So I created a port channel 1 again on this router, R2, and then two sub-interfaces, one for 100 and VLAN 100 and then VLAN 1000, and attached it to the physical port on R2 facing towards R1. And that took care of the communication between R1 and R2 in a divided way. So nowhere until R2, the green network and blue network can talk to each other. They are kept separate. So now if two routers want to talk to each other, then the routing has to be advertised and distributed across them. So that is done with the help of BGP protocol. So that is the next topic we're going to talk about. So looking at the R1, it understands two different networks, 192.168.2.0 and 192.168.1.0. These two, even though they are kept separate, they have to be advertised to R2 so that R2 can understand what they are. So R2 can communicate to the green and blue networks, even though they are kept separately. And similarly, there is another network, the R3 routers network is also should be made available to R2, but we will see that in a moment. But if there is any other network that is attached to R2, then that also needs to be advertised to R1. So this is accomplished with the help of BGP protocol. So now let us look at the BGP configuration on R1. Let's minimize this for a moment. Okay, so this is the... Let me do the show run again. We already talked about these VRFs and skip all these things over here. We already talked about this interface for channels and sub-interfaces and so on. And here is the BGP definition. So the first thing that you need to understand when it comes to BGP is the ASN number, the autonomous system number. For R1, I have assigned 65,000. And then I attached router ID. It can be anything. Generally, they assign the IP address associated with that network between the routers. And then I created two sections for each VRF. So this section is for the VRFA and followed by the section for VRFB. So inside this section, I advertised the network. So VRFA, as we saw earlier, is the VLAN 1000 network, which is 192.168.1.0 network. So you need to specify that explicitly. So this is the network I want R2 to understand. So R1 is providing this information across the cable to R2. And similarly for VRFB, the green network, 192.168.2.0 network, is made available to R2. But then what is this 172.16.1.2 IP address? That is a tiny network between R1 and R2. It need not have to be /24, it can even be /30 or 29. Two IP addresses are required to connect these two routers, and this is 172.16.1.1 on the R1 side and 172.16.1.2 on the R2 side. So from R1's perspective, the neighbor is R2 via 172.16.1.2. And we're going to see in a moment, the neighbor of R2 is R1, of course R3 also, but for now, focusing on R1 and R2 only, the neighbor of R2 is R1 via 172.16.1.1 IP address. But we created a couple of port channels, and they carry the same IP address as you would have noticed earlier. Let's go back to R1 again. So 172.16.1.2, that is the IP address on the R2 side. And the ASN number of R2 is 64,000. So you mention inside the BGP definition, inside the address family for the VRFA, that the neighbor is 172.16. A neighbor is 64,000. And that can be accessed via 172.16.1.2. Similarly for the VRFB. So these two, this is the same IP address shared across the port channels, if you noticed earlier. So when this is executed on R1, it will start talking to R2 and try to bring all the networks that are advertised on the R2 into R1. But we are yet to see the BGP definition on the R2, which we will see now. There should be something similar on the other side as well. So this is R2. Now let us look at its configuration. Let's not worry about these maps and route targets for now. Let's focus on the BGP directly. So here it is. So this BGP is defined here. The ASN number in this case, R2, is 64,000. And here is the router ID. Generally, it can be anything, as I said earlier. Generally, the practice is to put the IP address of the port that is connected to the router. And now here is the exactly opposite. The 172.16.1.1 is the IP address on the R1 side. And R1's ASN number is 65,000. And similarly for VRFB. So with these definitions, the couple of definitions on the R2 and similar couple of definitions on R2, they can exchange the routing information. Let me do the show IP route. It does not show anything because everything is under VRF. So show IP route. VRFA. And here you can see the 192.168.1.0 network is learned on the R2 through BGP. So the B stands for BGP. So this network came from R1 into R2. So the BGP protocol successfully borrowed, I should say, this network 192.168.1.0 blue network through R1 into R2. So what does this mean? That this router R2 can ping any IP address on the blue network. But remember, we need to provide the VRF information, 192.168.1.2. It works. So from R2, we are able to talk directly into the blue network. And similarly, let us go and look at the routing table on R1. and any network that is attached to R2, in this particular case 10.1.40.10.0 is the network attached to R2 towards R3, and that network is also made available on the R1 side. Okay, so this is how the BGP works. You with VRF actually, so the routes can be exchanged between them. So now here is the third requirement. I want both the green network and the blue network, of course, to be kept separate at the switch level, R1 level and R2 level, but they should converge into R3. So from R3, I should be able to access either the blue or green network. There's a requirement for me for this particular topology. So how do I do that? The way it is done is no VRFs are created on R3. And another VRF called Internet is created on the R2 facing the R3. So think of R2 and R3 communication is VRF on R2 and then nothing on R3. So now let's look at this VRF R2 and how this BGP communication or how this interface is connected with each other. And remember 10.1.40.10.0 is a network between R2 and R3. So now let's go back to R2. And look at the running configuration again. I created a new VRF called VRF Internet. Okay. And don't worry about this exporting and importing for now. So I created a third VRF on R2. And then I placed the interface facing R3 in that VRF. So interface Gigabit Ethernet 2 is the port connected to R3. So we are on R2 right now. We are looking at the configuration on R2. And on that port, Gigabit Ethernet 2, I added VRF Internet. And I also placed the IP address 10.1.40.10.10. That is the left side of this network between R2 and R3. And now, let us go to R3 and then look what is done over there. That should be the very simplest of all configurations. And then come back to R2 and then talk about route leaking. Let me minimize all these things. Sure. Remember, there is only one interface on R3 that is used, the Gigabit Ethernet 1, and that is what is configured here. So as simple as that, the Gigabit Ethernet 1 is the only port active on this router in this topology, and its IP address is 10.1.40.10.1. And also, of course, there is a BGP between R2 and R3, and on R3 side, the ASN number is set as 63,000, and there is a router ID, of course. And 10.1.40.10.10 is a neighbor of R3, that is R2 actually, and R2's ASN number is 64,000. And everything else is kind of decorative. So this is how the BGP is set up on R3. There are no other networks attached to R3 in this topology, so there is nothing to advertise actually. But to receive routes from R2, this has to be done. So now let us go back to R2. And let me do the show run again. Let us first of all look at the VRF definition on the R2. And we already saw these two sections. These are meant for going to R1. And here is the BGP definition on R2 towards R3. So 63,000 is the ASN number of R3, and it is connected via 10.140.10.1. And remember, a few minutes ago we saw the BGP definition of R3, and that is via 10.140.10.10, and ASN number is 64,000, and now it is the opposite, 63,000. So now, so far so good, but there is one final thing that we need to do, and that is there is a traffic from the green network on VRFB and the traffic on blue network on VLAN 1000, that is VRFA. They are kept separate, but they are able to communicate all the way to R2 through R1. But then how will they communicate to R3? So we need to provide what is called a route leaking from VRFA to internet VRF and VRFB to internet VRF. So unless we do this route leaking, the traffic will stop at R2. It will not go further into R3. And similarly, any traffic intended for either the blue or green will stop at R2. It will not flow further south. So now let's once again go back to R2. Let me do the show run again. So first of all, in the VRF definition A, I'm importing and exporting a couple of things called route maps. So this is a route map, internet to VRFA, that is coming from R3 into the network, and VRFA to internet, that is going from south to east maybe. And then this definition also exports and imports the route definitions. So 1.1 is the definition of of VRFA, and it has to be exported. And 9.9 is the route definition of the VRF internet that needs to be imported. Okay, similarly for the VRFB, the internet to VRFB is imported, and VRFB to internet is exported. And 2.2 is exported, and then 9.9 is imported. And once again, inside the internet VRF, it has to import VRFA to internet. VRFB to internet is also added, but for some reason it's not showing up, so I'm not clear. But the internet VRF has to import both VRFA and VRFB data, I mean, traffic. And of course, it exports the internet VRF to VRFA. It contains another export definition, internet to VRFB, but for some reason it's not showing up here. So here the 9.9 is exported from VRF route definition, but the 1.1 and 2.2 are imported. And now where is the definition of the route map? That's something we need to look at now. So here is the route map, VRFB to internet, and it uses a prefix list, which we will see in a moment. And similarly, the internet to VRFB, so this one route map is defined here. VRFA to internet is defined here, and then internet to VRFA is also defined here. They are all using a prefix list. And that is defined somewhere here. Yeah, these two. So internet to VRFA is 10.140.10.0. That is on the between R2 and R3. And the same for VRFB as well. And then here is the definition of VRFA to internet. That is 192.168.10 and also 172.16.10, which is between the R1 and R2. So this 192.168.10 is the blue network, and 172.16.10 is the network between R1 and R2. So both have to be included in this prefix list. Similarly, the VRFB to internet prefix list, 192.168.20 and 172.16.10 are all included. So with this setup, the traffic can flow from Green Network to R1 and to R2. Until this point, the traffic is kept isolated. Similarly, traffic can flow from VLAN 1000, the blue network, to the router R1 all the way to R2. And these two VRFs are kept separate without any merging or access to each other. And here, the routes are leaked to the internet VRF, which is on the right side of R2, facing the R3. And due to this leak, route leak, the traffic can flow freely into R3. And similarly, in the opposite direction, when network traffic is initiated on R3, it can go either to the blue network or to the green network. So let's do one more final thing here. Let me go to R3 and try to ping 192.168.2.2. It works. This is the green network. And then 1.2, this is the blue network. And similarly, if I can go to one of these PCs, I'm on PC2. Let me try to ping 10.140.10.1, and it works. So this is a very interesting traffic. If you look at it leisurely, the traffic is initiated from PC2 all the way to the switch, and the switch will send it to its gateway, the blue network's gateway, that is 192.168.11 on the port channel .1.100 or 1.1000, sorry. And from there, it will be routed to R2, keeping the traffic isolated from the green network. And from there, due to VRF leak, it flows into the connectivity between R2 and R3 all the way to R3. And the response comes in the opposite direction successfully as well. So now let's try one more from the green network. We can make it bigger. Ping 10.140.10.1, and it works. So I hope you understood the usage of VLAN, both access port and trunk ports, what is port channel, and how the port channels can be configured to keep the traffic separate at the router level. It does the job with the help of channel group and VRFs, which is equivalent to the VLANs in the level 2 networking, which is the switch. And we also saw how to set up a BGP. We created several BGPs here, this BGP between R1 and R2, another R2, another BGP between R2 and R3 as well. And the R1 and R2 BGP included VRFs, and R2 to R3 BGP did not include any VRFs. And we looked at the route maps, prefix list, and the route leaking from VRF to VRF. We were able to route between the routers, port channels and all, that is between R1 and R2. And the routing between routers without port channels. So there was no port channel between R2 and R3, but with a VRF, internet VRF on this side. So thanks for listening, and I hope you enjoyed this video. And please place some comments if you have any questions, or otherwise I will see you all in another video very soon. Bye for now.